Okay, so let's continue with filtering. And last lecture, I introduced to you derivation of Kalman filter. There are multiple ways of deriving Kalman filter. I thought I tried to do the simplest one, simplest derivation to derive Kalman filter. If you see, I just went through optimization approach. There is a way to go through statistics and probability density functions and so on. I'm going to make those connections now. But those derivations are little more algebraically complex. If you thought the earlier one was simple, then but if you go over it, actually I would strongly recommend that you sit and try to derive the expressions in the notes. Those 5-6 pages, it's easy to derive those expressions. It's not so difficult. If you derive those expressions yourself, you will get confidence of about what is happening. So let's just summarize Kalman filtering algorithm. In fact, my today's lecture, unfortunately today not many people are able to attend because of this, it's an extra lecture. I think it's equally important or probably more difficult lecture than yesterday's lecture. So let me summarize, because now in this lecture I want to go beyond what I taught yesterday. Yesterday I taught this derivation of this Kalman filter. First of all, you have to understand that we are dealing with a stochastic process X, which is governed by a difference equation. Okay. In a stochastic process, you can do prediction. Okay. Prediction is, why do you develop models? Because you want to do predictions. Okay. So prediction is integral part of, we predict the state before receiving the measurement. This is my state prediction. This is what I expect. This is the best value of the state, best guess for the state. Okay. Now, this is, as we have seen, that this is nothing but a conditional mean. This is a conditional mean of x given information up to k minus 1. Okay. Then it is not sufficient to characterize only mean. I want to characterize the uncertainty associated with the mean with this random variable. So covariance comes into picture. So we have this expression for the covariance. Okay. So this tells you that the covariance associated with the prediction is function of the covariance associated with the previous updated mean. Okay. See, x hat k given k minus 1 given k minus 1 is the previous updated mean. Okay. Covariance associated with this is p k minus 1 given k minus 1. Okay. This only relates the uncertainty at the previous time step, okay, with the uncertainty at the current time step. Okay. So this is a stochastic process in which the density at a new time step is associated with the density at the previous time step. Okay. It's a function. See, in fact, the viewpoint I'm going to present today is that these densities are nothing but, you can be viewed as Gaussian normal densities. Okay. So you can view this as a Gaussian normal process, Gaussian normal densities. Gaussian normal densities can be characterized by mean and variance or mean and covariance. So it is sufficient for me to have, you know, update of mean and update of covariance. Okay. Actually, what I am doing is I am describing a stochastic process through propagation of its mean in time and propagation of its variance in time. Okay. So this is predicted mean, this is predicted covariance. Okay. Now, when the measurement arrives, okay, I want to fuse the measurement with the predicted estimate and I want to do a correction. The correction step or the update step. Okay. For that you need this gain. The Kalman gain is computed. We saw that optimal Kalman gain, I am calling it L star, in the previous slides, I have this LK. LK is any arbitrary gain, L star is the optimal gain. Okay. The optimal gain can be computed using cross covariance of estimation error and innovation. Epsilon is estimation error, okay, and E is innovation. This cross covariance multiplied by innovation variance or innovation covariance inverse, post multiplied. It is very important here, post multiplied. These are all matrices, okay. And this, this is that quantity. We had computed this quantity earlier, we had computed this quantity earlier separately. I am just putting the expressions now. So, there is a recursive expression to compute the gain, okay. This gain, if you notice, is the function of uncertainty associated with the estimate, that is pk. It is also function of, now this pk given k minus 1 is function of q. Q is the uncertainty associated with the state error. What is r? R is the uncertainty associated with measurements, okay. R is the uncertainty. See, what are the three sources of uncertainty in your difference equation? One is the state noise WK, okay. Second is, you know, the initial state. This itself, see, this is a difference equation, this is the initial state. This initial state itself is uncertain, right. So, this initial state is uncertain. So, there are three sources of uncertainty. Initial state, when you go from k minus 1 to k, okay. Second source of uncertainty is WK, okay. Third source of uncertainty is VK, measurement noise, okay. Now, all three play role in this gain estimation, okay. All three of them play role. Now, if you see this, okay, well, I should not be talking in terms of ratios, because this is this matrix into this matrix inverse, but in some sense, if you see here, this is, you know, uncertainty, prediction uncertainty plus, you know, this Q which is coming of WK, okay, divided by, in some sense divided by, I should not be using divided by because this is a matrix, okay, but if you do a scalar case, you will see that a ratio will come, and you know, this R here is coming in the, you know, in some sense it is coming as a denominator. If you take a scalar case, it will come as a denominator. So, what it means is that we are trying to find out that fraction. See, this Q appears in the numerator as well as in the denominator, okay, whereas R appears only in the denominator, okay. So, we are trying to find out that fraction which is because of W. Okay, we want that gain which is because of W, and then we want to use that to correct the estimate, okay. Now, update comes through the correction, okay. So, LK times EK, and where is the information about WK and VK contained in? It is contained in YK. So, YK minus predicted output innovations will have that information, okay. Some fraction of it, what is that fraction? Decided by this covariance, decided by this LK matrix, gain matrix. This LK matrix is used to fuse the measurements with the state estimate of the model. So, my model, remember, is running in parallel in my computer. Only thing that is coming from outside, okay, are data. One thing that is coming from outside or that is coming from outside is the measurement Y, okay. U is something that computer decides. Either a controller decides or operator decides. You know, as an operator, you are tweaking, so you know those values of U, okay. So, I am going to do a correction here in my state, and this is the uncertainty associated with the correction. See, this is the uncertainty associated with the prediction, this is the uncertainty associated with the correction, okay. Now, what I expect is when I do a correction, uncertainty should reduce. I have got some information from the plant, okay. I use that information and use it to correct the state estimate. This is my correction step, right. So, in some sense, x hat k given k should be a better estimate of the state than k given k minus 1. Okay. So, what I would expect is that uncertainty associated with it, okay, with xk given k minus 1 should be higher, should be larger than uncertainty associated with the k given k. This is indeed the case. Okay. Yeah. Prediction step. Yeah, because we have taken the expected value of WK to be 0. So, we have taken the best estimate that we have for or mean of WK, that is 0. We add the state noise, something equivalent to state noise component. Some compensation for the fact that state noise has actually influenced X. Okay. No. What is unwanted for you is the measurement noise. Okay. WK is a real input. I mean, you can say that it's an imposter for a real input. We have tried to create a model that kind of imitates some real input. Okay. Which is influencing the state. Some uncertainty which is influencing the state. Okay. We don't have an explicit handle for it. We don't have an explicit measurement. We are trying to create a pseudo compensation for it through this. See, yk brings an effect of wk minus 1. Okay. And then somehow I want to use that information and, you know, inject it into my estimate. Okay. So, this correction is an attempt to make an compensation for that using. Okay. See, have we done this kind of a thing earlier? We have. When we have looked at time series models, ARX models, Box Jenkins models, I am going to do a connection in today's class hopefully. I am going to show that actually what we are developing is a form of time series model. And I will also show that the steady state Kalman filter, I am going to talk about something called steady state Kalman filter. So, steady state Kalman filter is nothing but Box Jenkins model. Okay. So, what was the attempt in time series modeling? Unknown input modeling, right? Unmeasured disturbance modeling. Okay. Here is the same thing. The same thing. Okay. See, in Box Jenkins model or in Ermac's model, we had this EK, right? EK was innovation. Innovation was YK minus Y hat K given K minus 1. Okay. This EK and that EK are not different. I will do the connection, then you will realize that actually, you know, we are talking same thing into two different languages. Okay. It's the same idea, different ways of parameterization, different approaches actually finally lead you to the same fundamental idea. Okay. So actually in your assignment, when you develop let's say Ermac's model, okay, and when you convert it into state space form, actually you have identified a Kalman filter from data. Okay, so I will come to that. but you know, historically these two things have probably emerged completely differently, and then now you can see those global connections, you know, or maybe those who developed it knew all those connections. We are late in understanding those. So, if you see Leung's book, he will talk about connections with Kalman filtering very clearly. Only thing which I am somewhat disappointed is that he has put it as a exercise problem hidden in. So, it should have been prominently, you know, there in the main part of the text saying that actually this is a Kalman filter, it's not different. So, unless somebody goes and solves those exercise problems, you wouldn't realize that you know, actually a Box Jenkins model or Ermac's model is a parameterization of Kalman filter. Okay, anyway, we will do this connections. So, is this clear? Okay, so we are hopping in time. Okay, we are going from time k minus 1 to k, and every time we are finding the new density function associated with it. Okay, now where is a density function coming in? Till now I only talked about mean and covariance. Let's now try to associate some real density function, which is, before that let me say something about covariance reduction. Okay. The nice thing about positive definite matrices, okay, is that you can compare them. You can say that this matrix is greater than this matrix, only for positive definite or for negative definite, of course. Indefinite matrices, you can do this. Positive definite matrices, you can talk about a matrix, one positive definite matrix being greater than the other positive definite matrix. Okay. So actually, a positive definite matrix can be associated with some kind of closed contours in the x1. Suppose you take a simple case of x1, x2, okay, and if you draw the locus of points, see what I'm trying to show here is that no, it is X transpose PX. It is X transpose PX comparison. So here, see, what is a positive definite matrix? A positive definite matrix is X transpose PX is greater than 0 if X is not equal to 0, okay, and this is equal to 0 if X is equal to 0 vector, right. This is a positive definite matrix, okay. I can actually compare two matrices if we say that matrix P1 is greater than matrix P2 if X transpose P1 X is greater than X transpose P2 X or X transpose P1 X minus X transpose P2 X is greater than 0, okay, or other way you can put, that is X transpose P1 P2 X minus X transpose P1 X is less than 0, either one of them, okay. So actually, if you take set of all points such that X transpose P1 X is equal to 1 and X transpose P2 X is equal to 1, okay. If you take this locus, actually in general, first of all know that if you take a locus of points, X transpose P X equal to constant, okay, so this will turn out to be ellipses. This will turn out to be closed ellipses like this. If you take, let us say, x1, x2, so this is in two dimensional case. So this is x1 and this is, say, x2. Then in two dimensional space, you know, so this. This will be some C1, C2, C3, and actually C1 will be greater than C2 will be greater than C3 and so on, okay. So locus of these points for a given positive definite matrix are ellipses, okay. And when you have this inequality, which means that if you compare the ellipses of P1 and P2, okay, ellipse created by P1 will be larger than the ellipse created by P2, okay. So actually this ellipse size for a fixed, say if you take X transpose P2 X is equal to 1 and X transpose P1 X is equal to 1, if you compare these sizes, see, then you can get idea of size of uncertainty. See, if the ellipse is smaller, uncertainty is smaller. If ellipse is larger, uncertainty is larger. Larger covariance will give you larger ellipse, smaller covariance will give you smaller ellipse, okay. So what I want to show here, well, I have not drawn exactly, the ellipses I have drawn here are aligned along the axis. In general, for a general positive definite matrix, they will be aligned, they might be tilted. Okay. So, I have just created a cartoon which is convenient to draw. It was difficult for me to tilt this. If someone, one of you can explain how to tilt this ellipses, I could improve this cartoon. But the idea is that what is happening is that this matrix PK given K is actually smaller than PK given K minus 1. Why am I saying this? See, let's go back here. Okay, let's go back here. If you okay, you look at this quantity here, PK K is PK given K minus 1 minus this quantity, minus this quantity. Now, this quantity which is here, is this always positive definite? L, see, this is PE is a covariance matrix. Covariance matrix is positive definite. Okay, so its inverse is positive definite. Okay, then if you take a matrix, okay, multiply it by a positive definite matrix and multiply by transpose of that matrix LK. This whole thing is a positive definite matrix. Okay, so actually you are subtracting a positive definite matrix from a another positive definite matrix. Okay, so this matrix should be smaller. Okay, this matrix should be smaller than PKK should be smaller than, because you are removing a positive term in some sense. Okay, you are removing some positive term from the original matrix. So the covariance associated in the update step, the covariance associated with with the estimate reduces. Okay, so this is very, very critical. This is very, very nice thing that happens. Okay, so now actually we have developed a filter which systematically takes into account stochastic description of the unknown signals. We have a way of doing optimal filtering. Okay, there are some questions to be answered. Okay, if this is optimal, but is this stable? Okay, stability concept, stability idea is still not answered. Okay, but at least we have established that this is the optimal filter. Okay, I will show you that this is at least under certain simplifications you can establish the stability. Establishing the full stochastic stability is little complex and it can be done, but I don't want to do it as a part of this course, but I want to give you at least flavor of how stability analysis can be done. Is this idea clear? That the covariance is reducing. Okay, moment I do update, okay, covariance reduces. So every time actually I do an update, more and more information I get, the variance associated with the estimate shrinks. Okay, so I should get better and better estimate every time more and more data I collect. Now, till now, I never made an attempt to associate any specific distribution to it. I am going to associate now the most wonderful distribution, most easy to handle, Gaussian distribution, and then relook at the same thing through Gaussian distribution viewpoint. Okay. Actually, Gaussian distributions have some wonderful properties. Why multivariate Gaussian distributions? Well, multivariate Gaussian distributions can be expressed in analytical form. I will show you that form, what that form is. Then this is a very, very important statement. I don't know how many of you have done first course in statistics, but if you have done it, you would have stumbled upon central limit theorem. Central limit theorem says that if there are multiple random variables simultaneously influencing some system, okay, there then combined effect is like a Gaussian random variable. Okay, each, there are multiple random variables, each one of them have different distributions, none of them is individually Gaussian, but the combined effect can be shown to be Gaussian. Okay, now if you go back and say that, well, did you see this statement, what is it written here? I am saying that sum of many independent and equally distributed. Some of these words are very, very important. I'm just I try to give a very simplified version in colloquial language, but the right way of putting it is that many independent and equally distributed random variables can be approximated by Gaussian distribution. This is a, you know, very, very powerful result. So if you know that uncertainty is arising from multiple physical sources, it is justified to model it as a Gaussian distribution. Okay, that is why. Now, why am I saying this? Let's go back here let's look at our original model. Yeah. Just look at this model. Okay. Let's assume, see, this is a linearized model, right? This is a linearized model. What is U here? U here is the known input. Okay. Actually, I tried to give some rationale to W by saying that, you know, we start from linearizing, you know, we start from a linear perturbation model, okay, and then you have these disturbance terms, okay, and then you make an assumption that these are piecewise constant. Okay, but just imagine when you are developing a model for a particular system, actually you cannot develop a model with respect to all disturbances that are affecting. You will develop a model with relevant disturbances. Okay, see, let's say I ask you to develop a model for temperature distribution in this room. Okay, you will develop a model with, you know, prominent disturbances. For example, I would say prominent disturbances, people walking in by opening the door. Okay. Random disturbance, which is somebody walks in with opening the door or walks out with the opening the door. But, you know, there could be some disturbance which is coming because, you know, there are electrical fluctuations which is causing some problem with the, you know, air distribution, and, you know, you cannot model everything that is happening. Okay. And all of these are independent sources of disturbances. Okay, their combined effect, okay, actually can be thought of as if it's a Gaussian distribution. Okay, so even though I have given here this rationale, it is not always possible to model all disturbances that are actually influencing the plant. Okay, so actually when you come up with this model here, so this is all fine, you know, we discretize and when we come up with all this model here, but moment I come to this WK model here, you can view. What is the other source of uncertainty when you are actually doing this? See, you actually started from a nonlinear differential equation. You linearized. Okay. And then you discretized. Right. And then you got this equation. Now, you know, one thing is that when I got this equation, I made an assumption that a disturbance is a piecewise constant. But they are not piecewise constant. So there is a residual disturbance which is not modeled. Right. So that assume that is an independent another disturbance. Residual disturbance which is unmodeled is like some other disturbance. Okay. There is one more source of uncertainty. Actually, my original system is nonlinear. I linearized. So there are approximation errors coming from linearization. Okay. That is another source of uncertainty in this dynamics. Right. So there are multiple such sources, you know. And then there are so many unmeasured disturbances which we cannot model. So if you view this W as arising from multiple independent sources of uncertainty, okay, then it is justified to model this W as a Gaussian distributed random variable. Okay, that is what the central limit theorem assures you. Okay. So all that I want to say is that when I develop this model, same thing is true about the VK. VK, when you are taking a measurement, okay, there will be errors committed through multiple sources. See, you have a signal, first of all, you have signal conversion. You know, you will convert some temperature into some voltage. Then you will have amplification circuit, right? You will amplify it, okay, filter some noise or something, and that will add some, you know, that will add some spurious signals into the, then you have transmission, right? You have to transmit the data either digitally or through analog, say 4 to 20 milliamps or some digital transmission, it will pick up some noise there. Then if it is analog transmission, then you have D2A conversion, okay, in your computer, it will pick up some noise there. And all these are independent sources, they are not, a combined effect of this can be viewed as a Gaussian normal distribution, quite justified in doing that. And actually you will see that if you try to estimate distribution for a measurement noise, I have shown you in the earlier lectures, it comes out to be almost Gaussian distribution, okay. So this Gaussian distributions are very, very important. Now there is something more to it than just the central limit theorem. They are also very, very mathematically convenient, okay. They have wonderful mathematical properties, and that is why also, by the way, we have not missed out anything about Gaussian distributions till now, because Gaussian distributions need only two things, mean and variance, and we have a formula for doing mean and variance, okay. So attaching Gaussian interpretation to what we have done is very easy, only two things are required to characterize Gaussian distributions, okay. So this is the first thing, that uncertainties arising from multiple independent sources can be conveniently modeled as Gaussian distributions, first thing. Second thing is, we have very, very attractive mathematical properties. If you take a Gaussian random variable, transform it through a difference equation, okay, the resultant is also Gaussian random variable. That is very nice about Gaussian random variables. Any linear transformation of a Gaussian random variable is also a Gaussian random variable, okay. This property is, you know, wonderful, and then it helps us to that is not true about other distributions. Gaussian distributions have this amazing property that when they are transformed linearly, the linear transform Gaussian variable is also a Gaussian variable, okay. And then, you know, for Gaussian distributions, optimal estimates have simple forms. So what I am going to hint at is that if you take a viewpoint that WK, VK are Gaussian random processes, okay, and initial estimation error X naught is also a Gaussian random process, all of them are Gaussian, not a process, initial estimation has a Gaussian distribution, and WK and VK are Gaussian random processes, okay. Then XK also has Gaussian distribution, XK given K minus 1, or XK conditioned on Y up to K minus 1, and XK conditioned up to YK, both of them have Gaussian distribution. Because, you know, Gaussian distributions transformed through linear equations will again give you Gaussian distributions. That is a wonderful property. Let us have a relook at the Gaussian distribution. What is a Gaussian distribution? It requires only two things, mean and variance. So if X bar is the mean and P represents a positive definite matrix, then probably you remember this complex looking formula. So this is exponential of X minus X bar transpose P inverse X minus X bar. You can probably make a connection with some of the square of errors. X minus X bar, okay, is like an error, okay. It is weighted by covariance inverse, P inverse, okay, and okay. This is an exponential term. What do you expect if X is away from the mean, this quantity will be large or small? If X is close to mean, this will be 0, right? X minus X bar will be 0, okay. So exponential of that will be a large term, okay. So actually this is trying to say that larger errors are less, you know, smaller errors are more, they are closer to the mean, errors are more, and you know this is only a normalizing factor. This particular factor which comes here, it only makes sure that what is the property of a density function? Area under the curve should be 1. Okay, so this part is only a normalizing factor. Okay, and if you look at this, this is like sum of the square of errors. Okay, so it is like exponential sum of the square of errors. What is the weighting function of the sum of the square of errors? P inverse. Covariance inverse is the weighting function. Okay. So the nice thing is that if you take x as some random variable, Gaussian random variable, and then A is some constant matrix and B is a constant vector, and you create this new variable z which is Ax plus b, okay, you can show that z also has a Gaussian distribution. Okay, z also has a Gaussian distribution. It's very, very easy to prove. Can you work this out? What will be the mean? If x bar is the mean, what will be the mean of z? It will be a z bar. Okay, what will be the variance? Z minus z bar into z minus z bar transpose, what is it? Expected value of z minus z bar. Z bar will be, z bar will be a x bar, right, plus b. Z bar will be a x bar plus b. A x minus x bar, so z minus z bar into z minus z bar transpose will be A x minus x bar transpose A transpose. Now if I take expectation on both sides, okay, expectation of this is expectation of this quantity, okay, which is equal to A expectation of x minus x bar into x minus x bar transpose A transpose. So this is A P A transpose, right? A P A transpose. Okay, so this is a very, very crucial property that if you have a Gaussian random variable, I am talking about vectors, okay, x is a vector, z is a new vector, ax plus b gives me z, this is a new vector. If x has Gaussian distribution, normal distribution, z also has Gaussian normal distribution, and from one, knowing one, you can estimate the other, okay, that is very, very important. Yeah. Gaussian. Gaussian white noise. Now WK, you can take Gaussian white noise. Other than Gaussian, see, white noise doesn't require, you know, what are the two properties of white noise? No, mean is constant, okay, and there is no time correlation, that is important. Okay, so if you can construct, see, mathematically it's possible. Okay, what we normally use conveniently is, yeah, Gaussian distributions. I think it's possible to construct Gaussian distributions which are multivariate. For example, I'll give you example of truncated Gaussian. There is something called truncated Gaussian distributions. Okay, so it's possible to construct, but white noise need not always have, for example, I think you can create a white noise with uniform distributions, at least one dimensional, it's you know, should be possible to have a white noise which is uniformly distributed. Yeah. No, not AX plus B. So actually, you know, the filtering which is happening through difference equation is actually linear filtering. We are all having linear difference equations. Okay. So with an algebra using this particular property, this fundamental property, okay, AX plus B is not filtering. What I am saying is that a consequence of this property is that linear filtering of a Gaussian distribution. So using this property, applying it to our difference equations, you know, this is the fundamental property which can be applied, and then you can. Oh yes, thank you. I have missed out the negative sign. Fundamental error. Thanks. Okay, now sorry about that. Okay, so so I am going to call this distribution as, okay, the notation I am going to use is n stands for normal distribution, x bar and p. So only two things are required for normal distribution: mean and variance. Okay. There are some other properties of multivariate random distributions. If you take two random variables, okay, which are Gaussian distributed, x and z, they are called as uncorrelated. This is just general definition for any random variables. They are called as uncorrelated if expected value of x minus x bar, z minus z bar transpose is 0, then they are called uncorrelated. I am just giving a definition here. Okay. This is nothing to do right now with Gaussian random variables. And random vectors x and z are called independent if probability density function of x, joint density function of x and z, can be expressed as px into pz. Okay. Now if x and z are independent, that means given any two random variables, if x and z are independent, that means they follow this property. Okay, then they are uncorrelated, that you can show. Okay, but if they are uncorrelated, doesn't mean they are independent, with the exception of Gaussian. Okay, in Gaussian random distributions, if you have two vectors x and z, and if x and z are uncorrelated, then they are independent. If they are independent, they are uncorrelated. This is true only for Gaussian random variables. Okay, in general, it is not true. Gaussian random variables have a special property. Independence implies uncorrelatedness, uncorrelatedness implies independence. Okay. They are one and the same properties for Gaussian random variables. Okay. This is just a property which I am stating here. All these properties have to be used when you do the analysis using this interpretation. Okay. Now, where am I going to use this? I am going to make a fundamental assumption that W is a stochastic process, is a white noise with zero mean, normally distributed, okay, normally distributed random variable with covariance Q. V is a zero mean. See, this symbol implies that V is drawn from, okay, normal distribution. V tilde is, V is drawn from, okay, that is how you read this. And x naught is drawn from x naught 0 0, and this is the initial covariance, initial uncertainty about the estimate that you are giving at time 0. Okay. So all three of them are normally distributed multivariate random variables. If I make this assumption, okay, then using the properties of Gaussian random variables, you can show that I am not doing this proof here. Okay. What I will do is I'll upload some, references, and I'll send you some references which you can refer to for further studies. But I'm not going to do these proofs. But what you can show is that this conditional, see, we wanted to find out conditional mean, right? If you make this assumption that this is Gaussian, W is Gaussian random variable, V is Gaussian random variable, and initial condition is Gaussian random variable, you can show that conditional density of X, even YK minus 1, is nothing but this as a mean and this as covariance. We know how to compute this covariances and mean, okay. Same thing is true about the conditional density of XK given YK, okay. So, if these three are Gaussian, these are also Gaussian, okay. This proof is fairly simple and I mean lot of algebra, but you can prove this using these properties, and I'll give you some appropriate literature on this so that you can pursue this. So, one could actually derive everything assuming Gaussian. I don't think Kalman did this. Kalman did the way we have gone about. He didn't assume Gaussianity. But what is wonderful is that you get the same result if you assume Gaussian distributions. The final result, update rule, you know, Kalman-Gale calculation, nothing changes. Okay. So, completely different viewpoint will give you same optimal result. Okay. That is very, very wonderful. Okay. We can also show that innovation itself is a Gaussian random variable. Those of you who have a lecture, you can move, don't worry. So this innovation sequence is also a Gaussian random variable, innovation sequence, and then it's also zero mean. We have already found out mean and variance for innovation sequence. You can show that even innovations is a Gaussian random variable. Okay. So with this assumption, and the fact that linear transformation of Gaussian random variables is gives rise to Gaussian random variables, you can show that conditional density of X is also, X given YK minus 1 is Gaussian, conditional density of X given YK is Gaussian, conditional density of innovations is Gaussian. So, very, very nice. This doesn't work out for any other distribution. This works out only for Gaussian. Linear transformation of Gaussian variables gives rise to Gaussian variables, okay. What are their covariances? You can estimate them, okay. Then, well, I'm just leaving some more interpretations here. You will need to reflect over it before you can get all the meaning. There are two things that you should note. Actually what we are saying here is that XK is a random process, okay. XK is a random process, and by this assumption, we are actually able to find the probability density function of XK, right? Conditional probability density function of XK. Okay. So this actually gives you the density functions. Okay. So what is the value that XK takes? It's a random variable. Okay. You want to give a point estimate. Actually, if you give the distribution, XK is characterized, isn't it? XK is completely characterized if you are given the distribution, is it? So actually it's like saying that this, the temperature in this room today, okay, has a certain distribution, okay. If you take temperature in this room as a stochastic process, temperature has a distribution. What value it has taken today is a realization. Okay, that is a realization. But if you characterize the entire distribution, you are done. I mean, then you know you have said everything about that random process. Okay. But what happens is we need a point estimate. you know, we need one value to say what is the best estimate. Okay, so if I give you a distribution and say that this is the random distribution, but you will ask me, okay, but what do you expect it to be today? Okay, so that is a point estimate. So actually, once you have distribution characterized, you have entire information about x. Okay, yet we need a point estimate. So how do you construct a point estimate? Okay, so there are different ways of constructing a point estimate. I can say that I want that estimate, okay, which maximizes the probability density function, conditional probability density function. Okay, which value of x, okay, maximizes the density function? That is the most probable value. I am willing to accept that as the most probable value. Okay, that is called as MAP estimate, maximum a priori estimate. So if I give you a lot of information, because density is a lot of information, you know, I cannot interpret. I want one number, okay. So, or I want one vector, okay. So that one vector can be constructed from the density information by multiple ways. One of them is this maximum a, so maximize this density, okay. So you can show that the estimate that maximizes this density function, okay, is nothing but the Kalman filter estimate. It turns out that the Kalman filter estimate is the MAP estimate. MAP estimate is maximum a posteriori, that is the value of x that maximizes this density function, is nothing but the Kalman filter estimate. Okay, so you can derive Kalman filter from this viewpoint. Okay, you start with Gaussian density functions, you develop this you know, density function, then you maximize with respect to estimate, you will get the same formula, you will get the same update rule, everything will be same. Okay, finally, but a different viewpoint, completely different viewpoint, will give you same Kalman filter. Okay, that is actually beauty of Kalman filter. Multiple viewpoints actually arrive, you arrive at the same formula. Okay, there is one more viewpoint. One viewpoint is, you know, maximize this density function. Another one viewpoint is maximize the likelihood function. Okay, so given a density function, there are different ways of, you know, constructing point estimates. One of them is this likelihood function. This likelihood function is log likelihood function, actually says that you are maximizing this or you are minimizing this sum of the square of errors. What are the sum of the square of errors? You are constructing that estimate which minimizes true minus predicted estimate. Okay, this is norm, this is, you know, weighted norm with this inverse coming in. Okay, this weighted norm between yk true minus cxk with r inverse coming in. Okay, why this r inverse and pk inverse are coming in? No, they are Gaussian, these are Gaussian densities. So when I take log likelihood, okay, I will get log of, see, what is Gaussian density? Gaussian density will be x transpose p inverse, right? So what is x transpose p inverse x? I could write this Gaussian density, I can write as, so this is 1 upon some constant exponent minus x bar p inverse x minus x bar, right? This quantity, I can say that this is norm of x minus x bar. Sorry, transpose comes here, yeah. So x minus x bar, this is weighted norm square, okay. So weighted norm square is x minus x bar transpose p inverse x minus x bar. This is a norm function, right? You can see that this is a norm function, norm square actually, not norm. So it's like distance square, okay. It's like distance squared. It's distance from the mean value. Okay, that's what appears here in the, okay. So, going back to our slides. Okay, when you take, see, Pxk yk or Pxk given yk, all these are Gaussian densities. All these are Gaussian densities. And when you take log of that, okay, you will get this norm which is R inverse or norm, because individual densities, you know, you can use all the properties of Gaussian densities of, you know, uncorrelated and independence. All those things will come into picture. Linear additions of, I mean, I am skipping all the in between steps, okay. I will give you those material on that. But this can be viewed as a, you know, estimate that gives you maximum likelihood estimate, or one that minimizes this objective function. So, these derivations I'll give you, these derivations are also equally important. So, what is the advantage of the Kalman filter? Kalman filter, it generates maximum likelihood estimates, it generates maximum a posteriori estimates when the noises are Gaussian. Okay. If you do not want to attach Gaussian distribution interpretation, okay, even then it gives you minimum variance estimate. We derived everything through minimization of variance. I never used any Gaussianity there. Okay. So, forget about Gaussian distributions. We don't know what distribution it is, but it is yet a minimum variance estimate. Okay. So, minimum variance estimation derivation did not require Gaussianity anywhere. Okay. So, that is very, very important. So, it is a minimum variance estimate. It only requires two movements, first movement and second movement. Okay. I am just done with, so that is why it is very, very nice algorithm. It is very easy to adapt for irregularly sampled systems. Irregularly sampled systems are very much there today. In which Kalman filtering is used, you have a data. See, let's take an example of a mobile phone, okay, in which the data y is the signal received, okay. If you have a Kalman filter and if you are estimating the state, state is the speech which is you want to reconstruct, okay, and deliver it to the person who is listening. If the data is missing, okay, if I have a model, I can do prediction, okay. I can fill in the missing syllable or missing data using x hat k given k minus 1, x hat k plus 1 given k minus 1, okay. Whenever data comes, I can fuse it and correct the estimate. So, you know, you can use all these ideas for signal reconstruction. You know, when the data is missing, and packet missing, you know it happens when you are moving with a mobile phone, suddenly the packets miss. But yet if you have a sound algorithm which can reconstruct the missing states in between, okay, using Kalman filter, okay, you have to have uncertainty modeled for measurement and for the state noise, okay, and you can develop, I am trying to give a simplistic viewpoint of this whole thing. It is probably much more complex than what I am saying, but you know, it is possible to do this, at least something equivalent can be done in process control. I have done this, it works. So, and this is much easier than pole placement approach, believe me. Finding out poles that will give you best rejection of disturbances is very, very difficult. It's not so easy. Okay. Another difficult part is now convergence, right? We talked about the optimal estimate. We said that maximum likelihood viewpoint, this gives you best estimate and so on. Okay. Now comes, as a control engineer, we are first bothered about the stability, then performance. Right now I talked about the performance first. I said this is the best estimator you can get. Okay. So, you should ask me, what about stability? Okay. Will it converge? Okay. It might be the best estimate. Okay. But if it does not converge, does not make sense. How do you prove convergence? Now, this is a little tricky task, because this is a time varying system. LK is a matrix which changes as a function of time. You cannot use simple eigenvalue analysis. We have to use this Lyapunov stability analysis. I am going to take a simplified viewpoint. I am going to look at Kalman filter as a deterministic system. I am going to ignore WK and VK. Okay, there are three sources of uncertainty: initial state, okay, state noise, measurement noise. State noise and measurement noise are inputs. Those inputs, let's say if they are bounded, you know, then we don't have to too much worry about the bounded output. If bounded input will give you bounded output. I am first worried about convergence with respect to error in the initial guess. Okay, so I am going to consider a restricted problem. I am going to say that it's a deterministic system. There is no error in the measurement. There is no state noise. Only possible error is in the initial estimate of the state. Okay, x00 and x0, true x and estimate of x at 0 are different. Okay, will error go to 0 between true and estimate? Okay. I proved it, no, that doesn't mean convergence. Expectation at 0 doesn't mean it converges. Different notions. Do you have a class or something you can continue? Yeah. Okay, so let's look at KF implemented as a deterministic system. Okay, so let's look at this simplified form. Okay, and so I have knocked off measurement noise, I have knocked off uncertainty in the states. Okay, Kalman gain computations are still using those equations, recurrent equations. Those are called as Riccati equations. So I have this pk given k minus 1 is this phi k minus 1 to phi transpose plus q. Then Kalman gain is still computed using the same formula, okay, and update is done using the same formula. So these equations are still the same, and q and r are some positive definite matrices, okay, which quantify uncertainties, some uncertainty. Right now, no interpretation from the viewpoint of noise, some tuning matrices. Let's take them as the tuning matrices. Okay. So my question is, if I have this Kalman filter, okay, if I have this Kalman filter, will this dynamics of error, will it be stable? Okay. See, this is my error dynamics. Can you just derive this? Can you just take this? What is the error dynamics? This is the plant. This is the true plant. Okay. And this is the estimator. Okay. What is the relationship for prediction error? And what is the relationship for? Just check whether you get these two. You just subtract plant dynamics from this, subtract this equation from the plant dynamics, okay, you should get this equation. UK, gamma UK will cancel, okay, you will get phi into bracket, just see if everyone is with me on this. See, I have this equation x k plus 1 is equal to phi x k plus gamma u k. Subtract from this x hat k plus 1 given k is equal to phi x hat k given k plus gamma uk. If I subtract, I will get x k plus 1 minus x hat k plus 1 given k is equal to phi into xk minus x hat k given k. Okay, so this is my epsilon k plus 1 given k, and this is my epsilon k given k. Okay, so that's what I have done. Okay, second equation follows from the update equation. It's not difficult to derive. Okay, so these are my, these two coupled equation define the error dynamics. Okay, I'll eliminate here epsilon kk. I'll combine this into this equation. These two can be combined into, eliminate one of them. I'm going to work with this prediction error dynamics. Okay, if I show that prediction error dynamics is stable, then this also is stable, because these two are related by a constant, but not by a constant matrix, but through a matrix. This is only a linear transformation of this. So if this goes to 0, this will also go to 0. That is not a problem. Okay, so one of them I have to show, that if I show that this dynamics is stable. Now I cannot apply normal analysis of eigenvalues here. Why? Because this matrix is time varying. This matrix is time varying. Okay, so I have to use something else. Okay. Lots of linear algebra. Okay, so first of all, I am defining two matrices here, which are pi k given k minus 1, which is inverse of this matrix. Okay, and pi k given k, which is inverse of p k given k. Okay, that is the first thing. I am defining this inverse. Second thing is, I am skipping huge amount of algebra in between. Okay, I am just giving you one result. Okay, this particular result is very famous result in linear algebra. This is called as matrix inversion lemma. Okay, very, very rampantly used in derivations of Kalman filtering. Okay, matrix inversion lemma talks about A plus BCD inverse, and this can be proved very easily. Just do multiplication, cross multiplication. Okay, and you can show that left hand side is equal to right hand side. It's not difficult to do this. Okay, you just have to be patient. Multiply all, you know, matrices properly. You will get I equal to I. Okay, this result is not difficult to prove. But this result is very useful, and I am going to use this result to prove a very complex inequality. Okay, what is this term here? This is inverse of p k plus 1 given k. Okay, I am going to use this term. Okay, I am showing that this term, okay, is smaller than, you know, this quantity here plus another quantity. Now this is a positive definite matrix, this is another positive definite matrix, and this is a positive definite matrix. Because why? Because pk is a positive definite matrix, so inverse of pk is also a positive definite matrix. Okay, so this inequality, with lot of algebra you can prove this inequality. Okay, you have to trust me with this. I can put up those derivations and you can have a look at those. The end result where I want to come to is more important. So there is some complex inequality which we have proved using this. Okay, how it's going to help me? I'm going to use it to define a Lyapunov function. Okay, and I'm going to use Lyapunov stability analysis to prove the convergence. Okay, let's go back to Lyapunov analysis. What is done in Lyapunov analysis? Lyapunov function is positive definite function and its gradient should be negative definite. Okay. So, I want to show that Vk plus 1 minus Vk, okay, is negative or is negative definite. Okay. So, as time progresses, okay, you know, Vk reduces. Okay, as time progresses, Lyapunov function reduces. If I can construct a Lyapunov function, okay, where I can show this, okay, then I establish the stability of the, okay. I am going to define a Lyapunov function using Vk is epsilon transpose P inverse epsilon. What is P? P is the covariance associated with the epsilon. Okay. But we have said that pi is equal to P inverse. Okay. So, this is nothing but epsilon transpose pi epsilon. Okay. I have just removed all k given k minus 1, all that. This is what I am doing. I am defining a Lyapunov function. Actually, this is the term, notice that this is the term which appears in the Gaussian distribution, e to the power, the same term. Okay. I am using the same term to define the Lyapunov function. Okay. So, I am defining the Lyapunov function like this. And moving on here, I have defined this Lyapunov function Vk, which is error at k given k minus 1 transpose pi, pi is P inverse into error again at k given k minus 1. What you can show is that Vk plus 1 minus Vk is a negative function. This difference is always a negative function because this can be shown to be equal to this term here on the right hand side. This term here appears to be nothing but this complex matrix. And how could I prove this? I could prove this because of this inequality. This inequality follows from matrix inversion lemma. I am not giving you a proof, I am giving you a sketch of the proof. Okay. I can do Lyapunov stability arguments. I can construct a Lyapunov function. Okay. Through which I can show that Kalman filter gives me a stable filter. If I view it as a deterministic filter, I only take initial estimation error into account. I forget about measurement noise. I forget about the state noise. Okay. I have considered a Lyapunov function. Which is negative definite. Okay. Vk plus 1 minus Vk. Okay. Is always a negative value. Why? Because this omega is a positive definite matrix. Why is omega positive definite matrix? You have to go back and argue. This is, see, what is this function of, what is pi k? Pi k is P inverse. P is a positive definite matrix. So, P inverse is positive definite matrix. Okay. So, this is positive definite matrix into a positive definite matrix will be a positive definite matrix. Okay. What is phi q inverse phi? Is this a positive definite matrix? It is always a positive definite matrix. Sum of a positive definite matrix and a positive definite matrix is a positive definite matrix. Inverse of it is a positive definite matrix. Okay. And then you are again post multiplying by a positive definite matrix. So, this entire thing is a positive definite matrix. Okay. So, I can show this Vk plus 1 minus Vk is nothing but this term, which is always negative because this is positive definite matrix. So, this term is always positive for any epsilon. Okay. So, minus of this is always negative. So, this Vk always reduces, this Lyapunov function always reduces. So, this is a Lyapunov stable system. So, I have proved stability of Kalman filter, okay, at least in a restricted sense. Okay, I have ignored the state noise, measurement noise, but I have proved at least for the initial condition the error will go to 0. Okay. At least the sketch of that proof is, So, I am saying that that is a formula. P and Q are some tuning matrices. Okay, and there is a formula for computing Kalman gain. What is that formula? This is the formula. Okay, this is the formula for computing the Kalman gain. So P and Q are some positive definite matrices which are some tuning matrices. Now don't associate viewpoint of covariance. Okay, so P and Q are some tuning matrices. Well, I'm trying to compress things that I have understood over say 7-8 years into few lectures, and you also just think that this is just sensitizing. If you pursue in this line, you will understand these things much more deeper, maybe than much more than what I have understood. Okay, so so this is a Lyapunov function, and then if you make some more assumptions, okay, you can show that it is not just a stable observer, but it is asymptotically stable observer, and you can even show that it is exponentially stable observer and all that. So I have just outlined that here, that if you show, if you can say that this covariance is bounded between some lower limit and upper limit, then you can show that this Vk is also bounded between a lower limit and upper limit, and you can prove you know, asymptotic convergence of error will not only the error dynamics is not only stable, but you can show that it is asymptotically stable. Okay, so that you can prove. So this particular quantity you can show is always a positive quantity, and the rate of error will asymptotically go to zero. Okay, so I have just put here the conditions for asymptotic stability. I have shown that if you make one additional assumption that the covariances are bounded, okay, they don't blow up, then you can prove even the asymptotic stability of where. No, that was just stability. It just said that it is stable in the sense of Lyapunov. I just said that it is stable in the sense of Lyapunov. Strictly negative definite, yeah. No, but I am saying here it is less than or equal to 0. So it can admit actually a positive semi-definite case probably, yeah. No, but if you admit this, yeah, but the equality will, but what if this omega is rank deficient and epsilon lies in the null space of, then if it is rank deficient, positive definite but rank deficient, okay. I mean, I am just thinking a mathematical possibility of, okay. So, for strict asymptotic stability, you have to show this, that Vk is bounded first of all, okay, and then it is not sufficient to show what I have shown earlier. If you can establish this, then you can show asymptotic convergence. So, so let me stop here. It's already quite complex. What I want to do next is to connect these Kalman filters with time series models that we have developed. That is my last task in this series of lectures. Once I have done that, you know, I have closed the loop. So we started with data driven models and we came to Kalman filters, and I will now show that actually Kalman filters have a connection with the data driven models and how they merge, where they merge, where is the merging point. Okay, so we will come to that in the next lecture, and then after I am done with that, I am going to start control. Okay, I am done with. So the next part of the assignment is, computing assignment, is you implement the Kalman filter. Okay.